So every question in this section is a U substitution. Things get a little bit more difficult when I ask you to integrate and I don't tell you that you need to use a U substitution. So that's how things get a little bit more complicated, is when you don't necessarily know if you should use a U substitution or not. So there's two tools that you have to do antiderivatives, well, really three. You can always do algebra whenever you want. The other tool is obviously U substitution, but also knowing your antiderivatives, what they look like, or really knowing your derivatives. So to do a square root, the only thing I can really think of off the top of my head, we generally write half powers when we do calculus on roots, or a third power, or whichever root you're doing. Unfortunately, there's 2x plus 1 inside, not just x. If this is x, I'd add 1 to the power, divide by the new power, and be done with it. But unfortunately, there's not just an x inside. So we're in the U substitution section. Now, I'm going to make a useless U substitution. And I'm going to show you what a useless U substitution looks like. So u equals x. What's du dx? What's the x derivative of x? What's the x derivative of x? 1. So we're going to go ahead and substitute now. So wherever I see x, I'm going to place a u. And wherever I see dx, I'm going to place a du. So here's the result of our substitution. So did anything substantially change? No, just switch a letter. Maybe you like u's a little bit better. So this is what I call useless, correct, but useless u substitution. That's like if you're doing algebra and you get down, your last line is 1 equals 1 or something like that. Confirms you probably started with something correct, but it doesn't really give you anything to conclude. So this u substitution is going to waste time. So let's forget about it and make a different one. So if you ever let u equal x, you're going to achieve absolutely nothing. You're going to waste 30 seconds or so. So you can't choose x. So what I like to do is think about what is the smallest u that I could choose that's useful. So I could try either 2x or I could try 2x plus 1. Those are two reasonable choices. If those didn't work, I could try 2x plus 1 to the half power. But I like to start smaller and go bigger. So x obviously doesn't work. Let's try 2x plus 1. So what is du dx? Just 2, and then du equals 2 dx. Now, I don't see a 2 dx. All I see is a dx. So I need to solve for just dx by itself. So I just divide by 2. So I have a half du equals dx. So when we take out dx, we're going to get a half du. And of course, all that 2x plus 1 turns into just a u to the half power times a half du. Constant multiple rule says that I can move the multiply by a half to the front of the integral. What is the antiderivative of u to the half power? Can I use the power rule, the anti-power rule? So add 1 to the power. Do that carefully. 1 half plus 2 halves is 3 halves. And either multiply by the reciprocal or divide by that new power. Now, we do have a multi-story fraction, so let's fix that. We're going to multiply by the reciprocal here. And 1 half times 2 thirds is 1 third. And I'm going to take u back out and put in the original expression in x, so that's 2x plus 1, the 3 halves power plus c. So questions on what's that?
The 3 over 2, where did it come from? The 3 over 2.
The power 3 over 2?
Yeah.
So I took the half power. That was on the antiderivative step.
Okay.
So technically, this is the only step that really had, well, there was a little calculus going on in our substitution, but the only step that really had calculus was going from that equal sign to the next one.
Okay.
So that's the anti-power rule. Add one to the power, divide by the new power. It's just like the inverse operation, which is multiply by the power and then subtract one. Except you have to do it in the opposite order. So you unsubtract one and then you unmultiply. So it all happens reverse.
So what exactly did we just find?
Oh, that's a good question. What did we just find?
We found a U substitution.
We did a U substitution. We didn't find one. What did we find? What does this mean right here? So we found the integral or the antiderivative of square root 2x plus 1. So how do we check this? What if I just made all this stuff up and put a box around it and said we're done? Take derivative to check. So let's do that right now. So maybe this is not the actual antiderivative. So how do you check? How do you check if you did an antiderivative correctly? Take the derivative. So take the derivative. Of course, it's an x derivative. So do that right now. I'll take the derivative of c, which is 0. You can take the derivative of the first part. What mistake did I make? The threes, they cancel. Why do I have a half? I shouldn't, if this is the correct antiderivative, I shouldn't have that half hanging around. So, I forgot the chain rule. What's the derivative of 2x plus 1? 2. So once I take care of the power, so I multiply by the power, drop the power, I have to do the derivative of the inside. And that's the chain rule. So derivative of the inside, 2x plus 1 is 2. And then 2 times the half cancels out to 1. So that is the antiderivative, because we took the derivative of it and got down to where we started. Generally, it's going to be way faster to take a derivative and check than it is to get your antiderivative in the first place, unless it was a pretty much a trivial antiderivative. You can just do it in your head. That's about the only time it'll be the same, pretty much the same speed. So checking should be a lot faster. So I'm not going to check. I don't think I'm going to check the rest of these. I strongly recommend you go and check them on your own. And if you make a mistake on web work and it shows you're not right, you can check to see if you typed in the right stuff. But after that, I would check your derivative and see if you get back to where you started. That's the best way to check your antiderivative. Normally, it might be good to ask somebody else, but just take a derivative. It gives you derivative practice, and you might think, oh, I just forgot a times 2 or something like that. For example, if I had a 1 here and then kept going, then I would have been off by a constant multiple. And I probably would have found that out by checking my derivative down here. So this next example is trig, and it's going to use thetas, not x's. You can use pretty much any variable letter you want. D is a really bad letter to use, but any other letter will work. So I don't know the antiderivative cosine of, if it was just cos theta, then the antiderivative would be sine theta, and I'd be done. But the problem is I don't just have theta inside, so what we're going to do is the same thing we did last time. I'm going to let u equal 7 theta plus 3. So what is the derivative of, this is the theta derivative of 7 theta plus 3. Don't be afraid.
7.
So it's just like the derivative of 7x, except we have thetas. I don't have a 7d theta, so I need to multiply by a 7th. Now, if you watch other people do u substitutions, you're going to find that most people, and including, I think, the way your book's written, don't write that line that I just erased. So this line right here, what I'm going to do is just write, it's optional. You can take the derivative on the next line and write d theta on the right side. So you don't have to write this line down. And you're going to find a lot of people don't actually write it down. All right, so go ahead and substitute in. Find the antiderivative right now. It's going to work a lot like that last problem we did. And how do we check to see if our antiderivative is correct? So we take derivative without even doing that. The derivative of sine is cosine. And the chain rule is going to give us an extra times 7 at the end. Derivative of 7 theta plus 3 is an extra times 7. That'll cancel that 1 7th at the front. So it looks like this should be just fine. Sometimes an derivative check is super easy to do. In fact, I think most of the problems I give you, the derivative will be relatively painless to do. Sometimes there'll be a little chain rule inside. Well, I should say every time there's a u-sub, that corresponds to a chain rule. So this one is 2z dz, so our variable z, divided by the third root of z squared plus 1. So we could rewrite this as the third root is the negative 1/3 power. So negative for the reciprocal of the third for the third root. What would be a u substitution to make here? So Z is going to be useless. So don't go with Z. What are some options? Oh, let's try z squared plus 1. You could try 2z, but you're going to find that if you do a multiple of your variable, you really don't change anything. You'll just have a different multiple in your integral. So go ahead and find the derivative. What's the derivative of z squared plus 1? 2z. Oh, it's perfect. Look at that. Right there, 2z dz. That's as good as it gets right there. So our integral is about to get real nice. And what is the antiderivative of u to the negative 1/3? There is no try, there's only do. So anti-power rule, what do we do with the power? Add one. Make sure you do that correctly, but you shouldn't be thinking right now. It's not a creative operation. This is just add one to negative 1/3. So that is 2/3. And if you're bad at fractions, no shame in adding your fractions off to the side. You can use a separate sheet of paper and throw that one out if you want, so I don't know you're bad at fractions. But do not mess up adding one. That's the easiest thing to make a mistake on. All right, u to the 2/3 divide by that power. Don't forget your plus constant. So all we did, add one to the power, divide by the new power. And u is z squared plus 1. I could multiply by the reciprocal. No reason to have fractions of fractions. So how do we check if we're right? Seems like we're okay. We got back to z's. Don't leave your answer in u's. U is something that you made up along the way. You have to come back to z's, or x's, whatever you started with. So I could take a z derivative, d dz right here, and I better get back to what I started with. So we're only doing two more example problems. So our next problem looks a little bit similar. It's got a square root and a product, but if I let u equal what looks like a reasonable choice here, I could try square root 2x plus 1, and let's do the next simplest thing. So let's not do the square root on the outside part. If this doesn't work, then my next choice would be definitely a square root on the outside. And so du is 2 dx. I don't see a 2, so 1/2 du equals dx. So we've got a slight problem here. I'll write our problem in red. That 2x plus 1 is u to the 1/2 power. So I wrote this in red because you're not supposed to have two different variables mixed together. When you substitute, you got to substitute all the way. You can't go and take out part of it, turn into u's and du's, and leave the other part in the original variable. How do I get rid of that x? What's that? Basically, how do I figure out what expression should go there? I made a choice up here. How can I use that choice to eliminate x? So we'll solve for x, figure out what is x, and then use that expression. So go ahead and solve for x up here. So this looks sort of complicated. I get a half times a half, which is a fourth. So take out the constant multiple. We have this antiderivative. Oh man. So we could try another u substitution. If I did a second u substitution, this would be a really bad move to make. So if u equals u minus 1, then I could, if I did some algebra, if I subtract u on both sides, that means 0 equals negative 1. So that's a really bad substitution to make. I mean, this right here, this doesn't really make any sense anyways. How could u equal itself minus 1? So if I did make a u substitution, I'd need a different letter. So I could go with a w, twice as good as a u. Now if I did this, I'd have to then unsubstitute out for the other u. So it turns out if you make this choice, you'll be pretty much right back where you started. So I'm not going to make this choice. U substitution won't help us out here. This doesn't look like an antiderivative or the result of a derivative that I know about. What else can we use if our calculus fails us? Algebra? So don't forget about the math you've been studying for the last 10 years to 15 years. So algebra. So let's go ahead and distribute right here. So we're going to use algebra. So this is u to the 3 halves minus u to the 1 half. So I just add the powers together. So u to the half plus u to the 2 halves, or 1 half plus 2 halves is 3 halves. What are these antiderivatives? So just remember, add 1 to the power. 3 halves plus 1 is 5 halves, divided by 5 halves minus 1 half plus 1 is 3 halves, divided by 3 halves. And fractions of fractions, let's get out of there. So we got 2 fifths. U is 2x plus 1. Two thirds, 2x plus 1 to the 3 halves power plus c. This would be a little bit more tricky to check with the derivative, but not bad. Just remember you have some chain rule going on. So it wouldn't be too bad to check this. This will be our last example we're going to do in this section. So this is the antiderivative of sine squared x dx. Now everything I know about sine, really just the derivative of sine is cosine, the derivative of cosine is negative sine. But I don't know anything that has a derivative of sine squared, unfortunately. If this was one of the other trig functions, I know secant squared, I know that one, but that won't really help me here. That would be 1 over cosine squared. So the calculus knowledge I have on sine is not terribly helpful. So again, we're going to use algebra, but we're going to use what we call trigonometry. So we have two identities that are useful. So sine squared is 1/2 1 minus cos 2x. And cos squared is 1/2 1 plus cos 2x. So I will write these on your last quiz and your final exam, so you don't have to memorize these. And if I forget to, I'll write them on the board at the beginning. So let's go ahead and make this. This is technically, we could call it a substitution, but we're not changing variables. So x is not getting swapped out for a new variable. So what that means is dx doesn't get changed either. So I'm taking out sine squared x, and I'm putting in something identical. Whereas before, we were taking out, 2x plus 1, and we were replacing it by something completely different that we just made up. So we are doing a substitution, but we're not changing variables. All these u substitutions, we change variables, and that's a really important difference to pay attention to. So we're not making a u substitution. We're not changing variables. So I'm just copying down the right side here, that 1/2 1 minus cos 2x. And that half could be brought out front. So antiderivative of 1 is easy to do. That's just x. You could go u substitution here, but let's try guess and check instead. So normally I'd recommend u substitution, but I'm going to do a guess and check instead. So I'm going to guess and say maybe it's sine 2x. I know it's got to have sine in it. What is the derivative of sine 2x? Cos 2x times what? Times 2 from the chain rule. So there's two problems. There's an extra times 2, and there's a fact that it's positive. So let's fix both of those. So if it's negative, that makes the derivative negative. And I don't want the times 2, so I'm going to go ahead and divide by 2. And it doesn't affect the derivative. It'll just make our result half of what it originally was. And if you want to think about multiplying instead of dividing, you can write it as negative 1/2 sine 2x. I recommend doing a u-sub, but you could do a guess and check on some of the easier u-subs. Make sure your answer is in the same variables that you started with. So in this one, well, we never really stopped using x, so I didn't have to unsubstitute here. But on all your actual u-subs, you do need to unsubstitute.